Hi, everybody. Welcome. We are really excited to have you here tonight for a great presentation from Mirna Valerio. She is going to be talking about awe, community, and outdoors, a perfect trifecta. My name is Erica Harris. I'm the development assistant at the Green Mountain Club. And I'm just gonna give you a little bit of overview about the club, a few tips on Zoom, and then briefly introduce Mirna, and then we will get started. This event is part of a whole series, the James Taylor series, that's been going for 29 years, and its goal is to build community and to share stories about outdoor adventure. And what is the Green Mountain Club? Probably most of you have some idea. You made it to our website to register for the event, but just to give you a quick overview, the Green Mountain Club manages the Long Trail in Vermont, as well as the section of the Appalachian Trail in Vermont, and a network of trails in the Northeast Kingdom. All of that adds up to over 500 miles of trails in the state, so we are pretty busy. If you've ever hiked up Camel's Hump or Mount Mansfield, you've been on a trail that's cared for by the Green Mountain Club. You might have also met some of our backcountry caretakers on a hike. They are stationed at summits and at ponds every summer season. And their job is to engage with hikers, educate folks, and also manage the backcountry campsites and outhouses along the Long Trail. So that's one aspect of the work that the club does. And I encourage you all to look around on the website and follow us on Instagram. We're at Green Mountain Club. And we will post there about upcoming future virtual events, winter hiking recommendations, and you'll be the first to know about what's new on the trail. I just want to share quickly the next event in our series, in the Taylor series, is going to be in a couple of weeks, and it will be done by Maya Dizak about paddling on the Mississippi River. So mark your calendar for that in 2 weeks on the 21st at 7 o'clock. Hope you can join us. Lastly, I just want to make sure that we give a shout out to all the folks that support us. We're a nonprofit organization, and so all of our work, including the series, is made possible by donations from individuals. So if you're a member or if you donated when you signed up for the event, thank you very much. And we also just want to recognize our corporate sponsors, businesses that have made really significant gifts to the club. One I want to highlight in particular is new this year, the Athletic Brewing Company. They gave $15,000 to the Green Mountain Club, and we're really, really excited to be working with them. Just a quick quote from their founder, who says, athletic teammates have spent quite a bit of time on trails and ski slopes in Vermont. One of their employees has even done the whole Long Trail. So that's why we're thrilled to be partnering with the Green Mountain Club and to roll up our sleeves along with the community for multiple trail work days, helping to ensure that the Long Trail is available for adventuring for generations to come. All right, so let me go back to Mirna's first slide here, and just a few tips on Zoom. If you're still getting to know this platform that we seem to all be using so much of, there's a few features that you will find useful tonight. One is the Q&A. So that's kind of what it sounds like. If you have a question, you can type it in there. We're gonna have time to to answer questions live with Mirna at the end of her presentation. Or if it's a quick question or something that's already been covered, we'll just send you a response in real time. There's also a chat feature, which is a great way to get a little bit of interaction going. Mirna will put a few questions in the chat over the course of the presentation, and I really encourage you all to contribute, help us feel a little less alone just on this side of the screen. And one note on the chat, when you type it in, you can choose if you're responding or if your chat will be visible to everybody, all attendees, or just the panelists. So we encourage you to share it with all the attendees so everybody can have a conversation together. The last feature though, if it is a good way to get just my attention or just the attention of the panelists, is the raise hand. So if you're having a tech issue or something weird's happening, click that little raise hand button and I'll get in touch with you through the chat feature and we can resolve the issue. All right, so without further ado, let me introduce our speaker tonight, Mirna Valerio. She's a native of Brooklyn, New York, and she's worked as an educator and a cross-country coach, but she's also an ultramarathoner, which is marathons that are longer than 26 miles. My husband has done some of those too. And she's the author of the best-selling memoir, A Beautiful Work in Progress. She started running in high school, but re-engaged with the sport in 2008 and started a blog called Fatgirlrunning while training for her first marathon. And that has really gone viral as she's shared her insights of being a larger woman in a world of thinner endurance athletes. She has had all kinds of claim and a fame from being in the Wall Street Journal, NBC Nightly News. She was also featured in an REI-produced documentary called the Mirnavator, which if you haven't seen, it's really amazing. Definitely check that out. In 2018, she was a National Geographic Adventurer of the Year. She's also been on the Kelly Clarkson Show, Access Hollywood, and in an LLBean short film called Running Through Barriers. So Mirna, we're so happy to have you here tonight. I'm gonna turn it over to you, stop sharing my screen so that you can take it away. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Oh, all righty, everyone. Good evening. Hi, everybody. And many, many thanks to the Green Mountain Club and Lauren Currier, Erica Harris for inviting me to speak tonight. The Green Mountain Club is an organization that has been looming very largely in my mind and heart for years as I have considered on and off doing the AT and the long trail. Still in the process of considering, so please don't at me with your peer pressure. That happens all the time on social media these days. I end up doing crazy things. And I'm so happy to have a chance to be in community with you, especially in light of yesterday's events in our capital. If you've come here to this talk of mine thinking and hoping that I won't address the events that happened in our country, I invite you to stay and to be here with an open heart, strong legs, and the desire to listen with the goal of honoring and acknowledging a different perspective. Also, I would be remiss and it would be a disservice to the communities that I serve to dismiss and ignore the big catamount in the room. Does that work? So I hope you'll stay. None of what we do in the outdoors exists apart from what is happening in our country. None of how we recreate amongst the trees or in lakes and ponds or on top of mountains or on our back porches or on our stoops on a beautiful summer day in the city is separate from the daily reality of our country. The outdoors does not exist apart from anything we witnessed yesterday, and it is in fact very, very much intertwined. When a Black body enters a space, it is often questioned and many times perceived as a nuisance. when even a known group of white supremacist agitators gains access to a public space with ease, it makes you question how this is replicated in other areas of our society. As a Black person who frequents outdoor spaces for my personal enjoyment, for work, for my physical and mental health and well-being, I'm very keenly aware of my existence and my body in spaces that are often seen as white spaces. The great outdoors in the American imagination does not exist apart from the erasure of Indigenous communities and the theft of their homesteads, the forbidding of Black folk from certain outdoor spaces, both de jure and de facto, the continued media representation of one kind of body, one kind of experience, one kind of outdoors. So that said, I'm honored to be the person speaking tonight. I'm honored to have this opportunity tonight to share what has been a crucial aspect of my own mental and physical health and wellness. I hope that by being here, we're open to creating more opportunities for all people, but specifically for people of color and others who are from disenfranchised communities, to experience the extraordinary benefits of time spent outside, of exploring our natural world, of doing the things all humans are meant to do. I hope that we're committed to disrupting the common narrative that people of color just don't do the outdoors. I hope that we're committed to examining why there isn't a greater diversity of folks out there on the trails. And trust me, it isn't because we don't want to. Questions like, will I be safe? Will I be stared at? Will folks question my existence? Will someone chase me and kill me while I'm out running? Loom largely in our hearts and in our minds and are all real concerns. And we have seen these realities playing out in real time over the past 10 months and frankly, over the history of our country. On a personal note, I've had the police called on me while I was running and training on my own street when I lived in Georgia. And every time I ride my bike on a particular street in this town of Montpelier, Vermont, I wonder if today will be the day that that truck with the flags will knock me over. Some of you may be thinking that I'm being hyperbolic, but this is my reality and the reality of being in this Black body recreating outside. These things are constantly on my mind and in my heart, even as I recreate in spaces many people think are apolitical. Everything is political. Everything is connected. And the more we acknowledge these experiences and fears of others in this great space we call the outdoors, the more we will examine what it is we can do as folks who love the outdoors and all it gives us to make spaces more equitable and less scary. Being in community with each other tonight is a step in the right direction. So I hope that as you listen to my presentation, your mind takes you back to the spaces and times that filled you full of awe and wonder. And I hope that you will use these good memories to extend these opportunities to others, perhaps outside your circle, and enhance someone else's relationship to our natural world. As someone who benefits from the freedom to roam and joy, and as someone who benefits from the opportunity to spend a lot of time outdoors on trails in this beautiful state of Vermont, I am deeply feeling the necessity of our time together today, and I appreciate you for staying. I am a former teacher of 18 years. I taught music, Spanish. I was the director of equity and inclusion at the Raven Gap Nacoochee School in Raven Gap, Georgia. Yay, Georgia. I'm an ultra runner with collaborative partnerships with many companies such as Merrill, LLBean, Highlands Homeopathic, Untapped, Nathan Sports, and Lululemon. I am a public speaker, and I get to speak all over the country from my living room and my kitchen. I lead workshops on anti-racism, and I have a series of retreats called Slow AF Trail Running Adventure Retreats. And if you don't know what AF means, please look that up in Urban Dictionary, because I'm not going to say it right now. As Erica said, I'm the author of the memoir, A Beautiful Work in Progress, and that has been on the Amazon bestseller list a couple of times. And perhaps most importantly, I am the mom of a 17-year-old who once went missing in the Copper Canyons of Mexico while we were on a trail running retreat in which we were running with the Tarahumara people. So that's a little bit about me. I would love to know where everyone is Zooming from, just so we can know who's in community with us tonight. So please just put it in the chat. I got Maine. Is Maine the only person? Okay. Bolton, Vermont, Nebraska, awesome, Springfield. Yes, lots of Vermont. I love it. Palo Alto, Ohio. Oh my goodness. I love it. I love being in community. Montpelier. Ooh, you probably see me from my window doing this. Brattleboro. I love it. Thank you. Thank you for sharing. So many people here. Woo! All right. Awesome. Okay. And I'd also like you to think about, and we're going to use the chat for this again. I'm a teacher, so everything is interactive, right? So we are going to, we're going to answer the following question, right? What is the most recent outdoor recreation experience you've had, either for pleasure, for your own sanity, or even for work, if it was enjoyable? When is the last outdoor recreation you've had? So please put that in the chat. You know, keeping in mind that outdoors might mean different things for people, different people. It could be urban, suburban, exurban, rural, beachside, backyard, porch, balcony by a lake on a mountain. It's all the outdoors. So where were you? Strolling with the pups. Oh my man, this is going by so fast. building a quiz hut with my third graders. Yay, teacher. Hi, Julie. A 3-mile hike in Jericho, a New Year's Day bike ride outside of Boston. Was it cold? Probably. Cross-country skiing 2 hours ago, running midnight New Year's Eve. Alpine skiing, I love it, I love it. What a great community of outdoorists we have here. Daily hike up to Silver Lake before work. I love it. 4-mile road walk in Cambridge. I love it. I love it. Thank you so much for sharing those, people. My most recent outdoor experience was time on the Irish Hill Trail right here in Berlin, where I was shooting a workout called A Winter Frolic for a special project that I'm doing with a network called Vive, spelled V1VE, and it's a project of Nigel Barker, who is a former judge and photographer for America's Next Top Model. And that workout included trail running, squats, lunges, jumping jacks, planking on boulders, and stopping to take in the silence and beauty around me. I always feel whole and my most human on the trail. The summer after third grade, a long time ago, I had the opportunity to go to sleepaway camp in the Catskills in upstate New York through my stepfather's union at work. It was a 4-week camp in which a bunch of kids from the 5 boroughs in New York City, I'm from Brooklyn, slept in cabins, most of us for the first time. And we learned how to swim and hike, and we slept outside in the open air by the camp's lake. And that very first night, after a 3-hour long ride north of the city, that was an adventure in itself, we had a choice of activities to choose from. Arts and crafts, that wasn't my jam. Basketball also wasn't my jam. Kickball, archery, and nighttime stream hiking. I had no idea what nighttime stream hiking was, so that's what I signed up for. I was intrigued. A group of us assembled in the quad, and we were led to the stream by our hike by 2 camp counselors. And there were about 10 of us, all new to this and all dressed in the wrong things. I think I had like denim and like, I don't know, some sort of like Converse on or something. And we started walking in the stream, like in the stream, like with our shoes on. The sun was going down. It was super quiet and noisy with bugs and things crashing in the woods. We screamed and yelped and laughed at all of these unfamiliar things. We swished through the water. And as it got darker though, we got progressively more scared. We were all from the city and many of us had never experienced this kind of silence, this darkness. The counselors had us stop in a culvert. I didn't know it was a culvert back then, but I just thought it was a big deep hole. And we heard things wiggling and splashing in the water, and we giggled and fidgeted, not knowing what was coming next. They handed each of us a wintergreen lifesaver and then turned off their headlamps. We were wondering, what the? And then they told us to bite down. And then magically there were green lights and sparks coming from our mouths. We oohed and aahed and giggled. It was so cool and so out of the ordinary for us. And when we had calmed down, we came out of the culvert, hung a left, climbed the hill, and bam, we were right back on the main camp road. I was sold. I was in the right place. And that was definitely a formative outdoor experience for me. It was new. I was in a new place with new people. I remember the smells, the sounds, the friendships I made, which were especially important to me as a very, very shy child. That unique combination of fear and excitement, that's something I like to bring to or facilitate for people in the work that I do, just like all of us who love the outdoors do, okay? So before we get into it, I want everybody to think about what their formative outdoor experience is, like what your outdoor story is. Was it an early experience you had in the outdoor? Was it something that just happened last year as an adult? Where were you? Who were you with? What were you doing? Why were you there? Think about those things. And then I'd love for you to share that formative experience in like maybe one or two sentences in the chat. So take a couple of seconds to think about your formative outdoor experiences, what they were, why you were there, who you were with, or just like put a place. Where was that? In the chat. We've got ice fishing with my dad when I was a kid, hiking Mount Washington with my summer camp, Girl Scouts, horseback riding. At 50, I pushed off a dock in a kayak. I love it, Girl Scouts. Early years hiking, skiing, playing outside with my family, daily walks, Yosemite Valley. I love it. Hiking on the islands around Maine, family, backpacking, camping, hiking, playing in my backyard, skiing as a teenager. I love it. Car camping, overnight camping, lots of camping here. Wildflower walks with my mom, a hike with my dad, summer sleepaway camp, Girl Scout camp. Oh man, these are such fabulous memories. Ice skating out back of my house. Woo! All right. Like on a lake, canoe tripping. I love it, I love it. Oh, all of these amazing, amazing experiences that we hold in our hearts are wonderful. Thank you for sharing. So I really love doing this exercise because it illustrates to us it allows us to verbalize and acknowledge how important the outdoors are to us and what our formative experiences are and how unique they are to all of us. So, nowadays, my outdoor story looks very much like this. When I'm outside, mostly in -6 degrees and above Fahrenheit, I feel like I'm my most human. I'm connected to the earth, to my most profound sense of self. And by default, I'm connected to other human beings. So this past summer, I was out hiking on the Long Trail on this flattish portion. There's nothing flat on the Long Trail, by the way, just in case you didn't know. But I was with my friend, Cara Richardson-Whiteley, who completed 100 miles of the Long Trail this summer, and I was with her. She's also the author of Gorge, which is being made into a movie. And we were hiking in a rainstorm that turned into a pretty loud thunderstorm. Most of you don't know me, but I hate thunderstorms. They scare me. And I actually wrote an entire chapter in my book on my fear of thunderstorms. What they do is they knock out all of my cognitive ability and force me to return to my most childlike, scared, amygdala-fueled, feral self. So normally when I'm with someone and it's storming, I'm comforted by their presence. But for some reason or another, this particular storm filled me with a nervous, anxious fear and existential dread. This was a fear and anxiety that I had been carrying around, much like most of us during the first 3 months of various COVID shutdowns, stay at home, safer at home, shelter in place, and lockdown mandates. In fact, just in case you weren't aware or you've been living under a rock, here is what we have been experiencing collectively. Heightened stress and anxiety across the board. We're constantly in defense mode, especially after yesterday's events at the Capitol. General physical fatigue, screen time fatigue. There are even studies coming out about Zoom and Microsoft, whatever that platform is, Teams fatigue, lack of personal time and or too much solitude from isolation and physical distancing. Loss of physical connection with communities and among families that cannot be replaced by online relationships and like Zoom weddings, but we try. Huge financial losses and general economic anxiety. And up until today, our lives have been reduced to basic survival level. Any safety we might've had pre-COVID and pre-political bonanza with respect to our physiological needs, shelter, nourishment, protection from ailments and elements, clean air, water, even clothing has been compromised. Some folks have missed months of paychecks, and that can mean lack of housing, dealing with food insecurity, or access to healthcare, all of the above. The rules and information keep changing, the goalposts keep shifting, and from state to state, country to country, we don't even know what's happening, but thank goodness we are sort of on our way to some possible solutions. There is this sense of lost identity. We identify ourselves in many different ways, where we live, what we do professionally, how we spend our leisure and recreation time. And a lot of that is gone or has changed immeasurably. All in all, our collective mental health has been affected greatly by this pandemic and our political situation. So I was carrying all of that in this thunderstorm, right? All this existential dread and anxiety and fear. And what scares me the most about thunderstorms is that I always feel alone, and I'm the only person viscerally feeling these rumbles of thunder, and that I'm the only one who feels out of whack when faced with these loud sounds and bright lightning strikes across the sky. So even though I was with Kara, and even though she had checked in on me multiple times, like a good friend does, I couldn't shake the feeling that I was alone in my misery and fear. The sky turned rather dark and gloomy, as it does in a thunderstorm, in a matter of minutes, and then sheets of rain enveloped us, and water was seeping through our high-tech waterproof rain jackets. It was raining so much, and nothing could comfort me. I was cold, wet, worried about slipping on the granite cobbles that littered our path because, hello, Northeast. And I was also slightly worried about maybe getting struck by lightning, because it is always a possibility, but we never know when or where it will strike. Is this a euphemism for like everything now? Probably. We hadn't seen any other folks out on the trail at all, not even for the 4 hours we had been out. And I kept hiking and trying to pretend a thunderstorm wasn't raging around me. And I tried to think of nice things like a warm car, a meal, but not in a restaurant because that wasn't a thing yet, or seeing other humans out on the trail. Eventually, we reached an intersection of a long trail in the AT and another trail where there was an abundance, or like an explosion of trail signs, you know, the carved wooden ones that are whimsical and artful. Now, let me tell you how much I love trail signs. I truly, truly adore trail signs. Like, I know it sounds odd, right? But here's what they do. They show you directions and how far to the nearest trailhead. They orient you if you're lost, or sometimes they make you even more lost. They indicate that a shelter or a vista is nearby. And most of all, they let you know that another human or many other humans have traversed the same path and have also wondered where to go next. They remind you that you are not alone, and that you have the footsteps of others to follow or diverge from, and that others after you will take similar cues and get to where they need to go. In essence, trail signs remind you that there's an entire community of folks who have done the same, who may have the same goals and dreams as you might. They remind you of those who may have similar blisters on their feet and stinky socks and hiking boots that may be well past their prime. They remind you that others have come to experience that same feeling you get when you walk through a very dense patch of luminescent green and dewy ferns, and you don't quite have the words to capture their particular brilliance. They remind you that the sunlight filtered through the canopy that you felt on your face at the top of the ridge was experienced by other human beings on the same trail, on the same mountain. They remind you that others, maybe on the same day, a different day, year or century, have had to contend with nature's whimsy and ever-changing moods, like a very long thunderstorm popping up when it wasn't even supposed to rain that day. Or they remind you that others have had to summon courage in the face of a fierce thunderstorm or something else that instills fear and trepidation, and continuing to move on with their journey despite being filled with fear. Yeah, trail signs do all of that for me. While the thunderstorm is still raging, I find comfort in knowing that I am part of something larger and more complex, and that I am not alone. I'm not alone. We are not alone. One of the gifts of the outdoors, whatever your idea of the outdoors is that it offers us a constant stream of experiences that connect us to the land and other human beings. Awe is one of those experiences. According to the Merriam-Webster Dictionary, awe is an emotion variously combining dread, veneration, and a wonder that is inspired by authority or by the sacred or sublime. The other cool thing is that contemporary psychologists agree that experiences with awe and wonder fire up areas in the brain that inspire compassion, social connection, generosity, and community. I'll say more about this later. Honestly, there's no better time to call upon the powers of awe, wonderment, and amazement to help heal our world from the various fissures that have historically and to this day are currently serving to tear apart our society. Have you ever stood on a ridge and marveled at the mountaintops all around you? Have you ever watched the edge of a microburst approach, not knowing what on earth it could be, but then witnessing the extensive tornado-like damage it leaves in its wake? Truly frightening, truly awe-inducing. Or maybe you've experienced this, running around a volcanic crater in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean while surrounded by clouds that occasionally break, giving you glimpses of the most beautiful bluebird sky you've ever seen. Maybe you've witnessed an extraordinary kindness and moment of compassion and wondered how or why that person was inspired to extend themselves in that particular way to another human being. I've had the opportunity to do all of the above and more, and each experience left my brain tingling and my mouth speechless, which is very hard because I don't quite have the means to explain what I had just seen, heard, or felt. These are all experiences of awe, of wonder, things we can't necessarily explain or verbalize within our own mental and experiential frameworks. Many times we don't even have the vocabulary to describe something because it's so far out of the range of our lived experiences that we have trouble putting the actual moment to words. Did anybody watch the film Free Solo? What the inimitable Alex Honnold did, scaling the face of the 3,000 foot tall El Capitan in Yosemite National Park. And I remember there's people from Yosemite here. You know, he did it without harnesses, ropes, or anything but his chalk bag, his hands, feet, and extraordinary strength and flexibility. What he did was beyond my comprehension. Sure, he trained methodically. He planned every step, every hold, every movement, every moment. He was ready. Yet the fact that he was able to complete this incredible feat was still unbelievable for many. That a human can scale a cliff of that magnitude is hard to wrap our heads around or understand. And maybe, just maybe, we don't need to reach a complete understanding of this. Maybe we can just marvel at this extraordinary thing, or maybe just trying to process it will force us to create new ways of thinking, new ways of connecting disparate ideas, experiences, and people. I believe that if we return to a state of wonder, and I think that as people who are in the outdoors and get other folks outdoors as well, if we can grapple with grandiose ideas and images like this often, if we make a concerted effort to experience awe on a daily basis, maybe not necessarily on the scale of an Alex Honnold or the phenomenally agile Ashima Shiraishi, the incredible powerhouse Simone Biles, and the strongest legs and hearts I've ever seen in Camille Heron, we can work on formulating a society that is built on connection, community, compassion, generosity, courage, and a willingness to be all in together. Sounds like a tall order and maybe one that doesn't make a whole lot of sense, but hear me out on this. We already know that time in the outdoors comes with extraordinary benefits. I know I'm not telling you anything you don't already know, but I'll remind you anyway. A reduction in stress-related cortisol and inflammation, lowered blood pressure and lowered heart rate, better sleep, more synced circadian rhythms, more self-reliance, better problem solving, better cognition, an improved ability to think clearly, a more elevated mood, a general sense of well-being, and experiences of awe, no surprise there. So I'm gonna ask you in the chat, where was the last place you experienced something phenomenal outside? Where was the last place you experienced something phenomenal outside. There was a full moon, I think it was last week. That was pretty phenomenal. I missed it. Where were you? Please put it in the chat, watching the sunset, Death Valley, winter hiking on the Franconia Ridge, evening puppy walk in the full moon. Yes, I love it, Stack of Karens. Oh, this is going by so fast, I can't even read it. Full moon, Antarctica. Ooh, winter beach sunset, cross-country skiing, seeing a beached dolphin get saved. Yes, I love it. Skiing, hiking in the Smoky Mountains, sunrise, fluffy powder, sunset glow. Ah, yes, all of it, all of it. Thank you, thank you. I love the six-year-old seeing the full moon glowing as bright as the sun. Thank you for that. Everybody deserves opportunities to have all of this, to have access to those things that make us feel better and do better as human beings. So this begs the following questions, and please keep on sharing. How do we regain momentum in our world, in the communities that are suffering from so much these days? How do we do the very best we can to assure that folks all over reap the benefits of all of this? How do we ensure that our resources, our material, financial, power, recreational opportunities, and otherwise are equitably sourced and distributed so that everyone can access compassion and connectedness? What is our role in all this? I think that there's an answer in the outdoors and in experiencing something that leaves us so stunned, we have no choice but to look to other human beings to share in that moment. I think that those of us who have the privilege of living, recreating, teaching, learning in the outdoors have a unique opportunity to bring community and connection to our world. What if we all had the opportunity to share an incredible moment filled with surprise and the sublime with folks that we don't know or with people we've already decided for some reason aren't a part of our community? This is one of the problems we face in our increasingly disconnected world. We're so far apart from each other that it's tough to have empathy, to care, and have concern about others that aren't in our direct sphere of influence. I'm reminded of a few years ago when I chaperoned many a backpacking trip with sophomores in high school. Yeah. And the entire team of 10th grade teachers would get together and formulate the hiking groups. And there was always a rhyme and reason to why we chose particular groups. And it was so that these students who mostly didn't know each other could experience the challenges and beauty of a life lived outside together. So after the initial, oh my God, I don't believe I have to do this. And why are they making us do this? And I hate bugs. And I don't poop anywhere except for in a bathroom. They would quickly get to the business of making sure everyone was well-fed, warmed, well-equipped, and well-rested, because if even one person wasn't, it affected the outcome, happiness, and safety of the entire group. When those things were in order, sometimes after many a false start, it was easier for everyone to be receptive and accepting of others in the group, no matter what their pace was, no matter if they were new to hiking or backpacking or having to use the bathroom in the facilities, or if they couldn't figure out how to tie the power cord into the right kind of knot so that the tarp cover would be sturdy. I, mind you, was in a tent. So when those things were taken care of, it was easy to be together and enjoy a sunset over the Blue Ridge Mountains, or to suddenly come across a 100-foot tall waterfall seemingly out of nowhere. And once that happened, all bets were off. The students would be singing chapel songs. We were a Presbyterian heritage school, so there were a lot of chapel songs. They were befriending each other, hiking happily together, discovering new things about themselves, asking probing and inappropriate questions of the teachers, telling stories and telling jokes. And they always returned to school with renewed energy and memories that they would harken back to and talk about frequently as they made their year, they made their way to senior year. Shared experience, shared curiosity, shared struggle, shared success, shared beauty. That is what foments close relationships, care for one another, and generosity in the face of challenging times. There's a real and growing body of scientific and psychological research on these kinds of experiences that connect us deeply. in an article entitled The Emerging Science of Awe and Its Benefits, two psychologists, Dr. Keltner and Jonathan Haidt, describe awe in the following way. Awe is the sensation of being in the presence of something vast that simultaneously transcends one's understanding of the world. It's a state of being that straddles the boundary of pleasure and fear. I think this is a much more concise definition and a concise and descriptive definition than the one in the Merriam-Webster dictionary. It seems so simple to say get outdoors or be an outsider or opt outside or get out, stay out, or any of the popular outdoor hashtags we use on social media to indicate that we love the outdoors and believe that everyone should be outside. But many folks don't have experience or access to these potentially life-changing spaces. I personally believe that folks belong outside, whether it's on your porch, on a trail, on water, on a bike, scaling a rock face, scrambling on top of a mountain, trekking across a glacier, swimming in your neighborhood pool, swinging on the swings in your local park, in your backyard, in the city, the country, the desert, the jungle, wherever you may reside. I believe that all of us deserve and need to experience awe. Everyone deserves and has a right to watch an incredible sunrise, like you indicated here in the chat, or hear the birds start to chirp in the morning, signifying that the day is to begin, even if they're crows or loons, or feel the solid ground of the earth on their bare feet, or witness their first shooting star. In fact, one of the first experiences of awe that I can remember was at the same camp where I went on that nighttime stream hike that was so life-changing. The camp staff had timed it so that we would start Spirit Week, the first day of the Perseid meteor shower. They woke us all up at 4 a.m. while it was still dark. We were confused as all heck because we didn't know this was going on. We put some warm clothes on. They had laid blankets out on and sleeping bags on the dewy grass and had us all lie down in this big field beyond the camp quad. There was only darkness and headlamps at first, but then we all quieted down. Many of us saw for the first time in our urban lives our first shooting star, then our second, then our third, hundreds. We oohed and aahed and grinned sleepy grins. And after about 30 or so minutes, we slept back to our cabins and slept a few more hours and then awoke to find all of the adults in clothing inside out and backwards. I will always cherish this memory. I didn't have the language for it back then, but that moment along with the stream hiking experience and the fact that I learned to swim in a vast bottomless lake, which still terrifies me, I admit, but I'll do it. The extraordinary rainstorms that came out of nowhere, which we played in anyway, and the way our bodies could do our final hike that felt like 20 miles, but I'm sure it was just 4, just before our camp ended. All of those experiences, the ones in which we didn't have the words or language to explain, connected us deeply. We might have come in as city kids who, though young, had already learned to hold people at a certain distance as a survival mechanism. But from the moment we were in that dark culvert, listening to the sounds of nature around us and watching the counselors' mouths spark with wintergreen lifesavers, to those moments that we watched our first shooting stars, huddled together on sleeping bags in a dewy field, those were the moments that I knew and felt deeply that I was connected to nature and to other people. As a shy and introverted child, I had trouble connecting to people outside of my family, but that was it. It sealed the deal. Florence Williams, in her book, The Nature Fix, writes, and I paraphrase, "The philosophy of awe, verbalized in the 1700s by Edmund Burke, asserts that it requires a vastness of extent and a degree of difficulty in our ability to make sense of it. It inspires feelings of humility and a more outward perspective." Psychologists have also theorized that awe is a unique positive emotion, I love that, that turns us away from narrow self-focus and towards the interests of our collective group. Paul Pliff out of UC Irvine remarked that an awe-inspiring experience can change someone's perspective for a long time, even permanently. And more recently, a 2017 study on awe and humility published in the Journal of Personality and Social Psychology found that by experiencing moments of awe and wonder, it forces us to feel humbled and drives home the point that we as individuals are small pieces of something that is way larger than we could ever imagine. This inspires people to feel more generous, more socially connected, more willing to engage in activities that promote the well-being of the community as a whole. And that, I think, is one of the biggest takeaways from this global crisis. What if we did, in fact, feel humbled and more socially connected? What if we were more generous and community-minded? What would that mean for the various crises that we're experiencing right now? COVID, rampant unemployment, structural and systemic racism, the heightened anxiety around our elections and yesterday and voting and all of that in the States. So in effect, all causes us to gain perspective, to be more connected with nature and to others, to be more concerned with our collective humanity and to be more generous. I think we have a unique privilege. And I know that I'm speaking to a varied audience of folks who love and honor the outdoors. Y'all, we have within you the incredible power to harness community, connectivity, and compassion to a world and in a world that is in desperate need of all of these things. The outdoors and by default, wonder-filled experiences are naturally intertwined in what the Green Mountain Club does and what we all do. So I'd love to know, what's your playground? The Green Mountains here are my current playground, and I'm not trying to move out of Vermont. So, so I think they're gonna be my permanent playground, but what is your playground and how can you be a bridge in your own personal life, or maybe your professional life, to the outdoors so that all can experience awe and wonder without barriers? How can you be a bridge? If you can share some ideas in the chat, that would be great. Let's see what you got. How can we be a bridge? How can we be a bridge? Listen and be an advocate. I apologize if you hear music in the background. It's my son, he doesn't care. introducing our friends to our favorite outdoor places. That's my favorite. Wherever I am is my playground. I love it. Dirt roads and water on my playground. Invite someone new. I love it. Being invitational, very, very important. Teaching others what we know about camping and backpacking. Yes, being welcoming vocally and with a big smile to others outside. Inviting friends to ski who are afraid of the winter. Yes, yes. Donating to organizations that help kids. Yes. Sharing locations in social media and how to be stewards of the outdoors with others. Very, very important. Extending the definition of what is a wild space. Wow, y'all. Work to protect our natural resources. Yes, not being pretentious about outdoor activities, striking up conversations with strangers in the woods. Yes, yes, yes. It's so funny, I've been in the woods a lot and you know, in recent times. And it's really funny how many people really make an effort to avoid speaking to other people. It's very interesting. Going to as many states and national parks as possible, inviting friends to go with us. Yes, yes, I love it. Thank you so much for sharing yourselves. So imagine if the world were set up where everyone had access to these incredible experiences. Imagine if we all had access without barriers, without fear, to a moment that connected us so deeply, we had no choice but to have love, compassion, empathy, and generosity for one another. So let's share our awe, share our vision of a world that is filled with courage, compassion, curiosity, and community. You've practiced and we're practicing this here every day that we exist in this community of people who love the outdoors. I love the term outdoorists. We have the power and privilege to harness something good in the world right here and right this moment. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you, Mirna. I think it's safe to say we're in awe of you, and you do. That was amazing.
Thank you.
So I want to just invite everybody to put questions that you have into the Q&A. There's one in there already, so we can get started with that. But we've got Mirna for another 10 minutes, so let's keep the conversation going.
I was very shy as a child. I know no one believes me. I just saw that in the chat. But this, you know, I am also a performing artist. So that was where I sort of became the presenter that I was. So thank you for that awesome feedback. I appreciate that.
Yeah. it's hard to imagine you being shy, but I hear you. So here's a question from John, who says, thanks for such a passionate presentation. And this I think relates to, you know, what we're already talking about in the chat. What are your thoughts? How can those of us in traditional outdoor organizations, which tend to be very white, reach out and be more welcoming to more diverse populations?
Exactly what people have said in the chat is, you know, by being invitational, putting money where your mouth is, right? I in my anti-racism presentations, I often say that lots of people put those black squares up, you know, during all of the stuff going on in the summertime, and that was it. That can't be it. Right? What you have to do is real work. Educate yourself about the communities, about different communities outside of the ones that you already serve. And, you know, without being patronizing, without being condescending, because that's a real thing. I've definitely been in situations as a kid from a city where I've been in programs that are like very patronizing. They assume that or they think that our outdoor experiences weren't valid. They weren't like real outdoor experiences. I spent so much time outside as a kid. That was my outdoors, my stoop, the neighborhood park, right? And acknowledging that, you know, making sure you do land acknowledgements, making sure that, you know, you, when you invite people to do things, that there are no expectations, right? And that you really truly are giving and not being the, not always being the, or having the, I am the expert vibe, right? We are all experts of our own outdoors, right? That's something, again, that I've come across many, many times. And so there are lots of different ways to do that, but like really putting the money where your mouth is, you know, if it's being, you know, invitational in your company or just in your life. And even when people say, no, you know, I'm not gonna go, or no, just keep being invitational. No, you let them know that invitation to go explore is always there without any expectations. There's a lot more that can be done. And, you know, connecting with other organizations that are already doing the work, connecting with community groups that already have connections to communities that you want to serve and that you want connections to, and listening to what they want and what their needs are. Very, very important. Thank you for that question.
Thank you. Yeah, we're definitely starting to do some of that work at the Green Mountain Club and having the conversations. And so we have a long way to go, but thanks for helping give us some ideas.
Everybody has work to do.
Okay. So a couple of folks have asked about how you balance your outdoor time with other responsibilities, being a writer, being a mom, all of the adult stuff that you have to take care of. Do you do any writing outdoors?
There is no balance. Just to be completely honest, there's no balance. Like this week, for example, this is like an indoor week for me because I've had a bunch of different workshops to give and stuff and a lot of meetings and whatnot. But last week, for example, I was outside every single day. I was cross-country skiing. I was doing that. And my son is older. He's 17. So, and he doesn't want to spend time with me. So, you know, unless, you know, he needs money. Yeah, so I don't have that. it's not a burden, but I don't have that to worry about, you know, like, but I did when he was younger, and it's tough, you know, wanting to go outside, wanting to do this, wanting to write my book. And he actually was in camp when I was writing the bulk of my book. So, and I got to go outside, I got to go to the gym and then write all day. So while he was in camp, and you know, that is, I had the privilege of being able to pay for him to go to summer camp for 7 weeks. I wish he could go now, but anyway, that's something different. But yeah, it's you know, I think there's this myth that we can balance things. I don't think it's possible. Sometimes I just have to focus on this one thing. Sometimes I focus on parenting because that's what's necessary at this moment. Sometimes I, you know, I have the time to write, or I have the time to train really hard, and that's what I focus on. I mean, I'm always focusing on my kid, but there are different levels of that and different levels of whether or not he wants me to focus on him. But yeah, so I don't think, for me anyway, it's not possible to strike a balance, you know, like they say, you can do everything, but you can't do everything at the same time. And I literally do everything. So, but not all at the same time. It does make me crazy though. Oh, I love this. Can I answer this? Does my son like to be outside? Yes. I mean, he also grew up outside riding his bike and stuff. And nowadays, and I don't praise him too much for it because then it would like freak him out, but he runs, he'll go out and run. And I don't have to tell him to run or anything. He's a basketball player as well. And he just goes out on his own and runs. And, you know, he goes on a recreational path right here in Montpelier, and he loves it. He loves Vermont, but he won't say it. He loves it here. I'm so happy.
That's awesome. Yeah. And a few people have asked how you ended up in Vermont, how you made your way here, Georgia or other
places. Very good question. I'd always come to Vermont for a race or in the summertime, right? And I was like, oh my God, I love this place. I love the mountains. I love Stowe, because I'd done the Catamount Ultra, where I always would sign up for the 50K and then drop down to the 25K because there was so much to do in Stowe. So I was like, I'm just gonna eat this pizza. I'm not gonna do another loop. And I'm just gonna go hang out with my mom, because there's you know, like the PK coffee shop or that I wanted to go to. And I fell in love with it. And then when I left teaching in 2018, I was really determined to go back and live in New Jersey. I love New Jersey. I lived there for a while as a teacher in central New Jersey, where there are hills and you know, some mountains, and or access to the mountains in northern Jersey. And so I wanted to move back there, but my friend who lives here in Barrie said, "Hey, come up for a winter adventure." And I was like, "All right, I have my own schedule now. I have to, no one determines my schedule anymore because I'm not a teacher." So, thank goodness I'm not a teacher. If anybody's a teacher here right now, I applaud you. Kudos to you. I love you. Thank you for the work that you're doing. So I came up here for a week, drove into Montpelier. Cause I stayed here at the inn at Montpelier. And which is not as fancy as it sounds, and I saw a Black Lives Matter flag, and then I saw a Pride flag, and I was like, "Oh, okay, well, is this a message that that this is the kind of community that I would want to live in?" Right? It was like 2 o'clock in the morning, and then we had this incredible week. We took a snowboard lesson. That is not my sport, by the way. we snowshoed. We did some other hiking. We ate really good food. There was something else that we did. Oh, we went indoor rock climbing at Metro Rock, and which I think is in Williston maybe, or Essex Junction. And we just had an amazing time. And I was like, I need to live here. That was it. It was 1 week here. And it was in the dead of winter. There was already like 4 feet of snow in the woods. And I found an apartment that week. I was like, I need to live here. And then I signed a lease a couple of days after that. And that was in January of 2019. I'm not leaving. Y'all are stuck with me.
Well, we're very glad to have you. There's some other questions here that says, you know, when's Myrna gonna start leaving hikes for GMC, and when can you come to my school? So I think there's a lot of Vermonters really excited to have you.
So wonderful. I love Vermont.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
Definitely. Well, there's still a good number of questions in here. Can I ask you?
Yeah, sure.
Maybe just one or two more. This is sort of a fun one. What's your ultimate bucket list outdoor experience? Haven't done yet.
There's so many. Oh my God. I don't have an ultimate because there's so many things to do. I do want to do the AT. I really do. I'm not there mentally yet, but I really do want to do it. In fact, I named my car Grandma Gatewood. So I just call her Grandma. And that was a car that I bought knowing that I would be driving the mountains. And so I named her Grandma Gatewood. And in addition to that, I'd love to do the Camino de Santiago de Compostela in Spain. But I kind of want to do it off season, where there's not a bunch of Americans. and I want to do it by myself. And then I would love to, I'm actually going to one of my bucket list places in August. I just got confirmation this morning, to Chamonix in France. I got an invite to do the UTMB, which is an ultra trail du Mont Blanc, but I'm not doing the ultra trail du Mont Blanc. I had surgery a couple months ago on my knee, but I'm going to do the fun run, which is, you know, normally a fun run is like a 5K, a 10K, you know. This is a 40K with 7,500 feet of elevation gains, the fun run, and it's for the volunteers and townspeople. So that's the one that I'm gonna do. And I was invited as like a social media influencer and a writer. So like I'll be doing a lot of storytelling and stuff. So I'm so excited. But a bucket list item that I have for that is to do the trail around Mont Blanc and like go from lodge to lodge backpacking. So yeah, there are tons and tons of things. I mean, I'm going to go to South Africa and like do, you know, go to like the whole Zambezi Falls. I want to do everything. I'm going to go to New Zealand, Australia. I want to do literally all of it. I would like to go hiking and trekking in Antarctica as well. I can go on and on.
Yeah, that's a pretty awesome list. Right. Well, yeah, I think we could probably go on another hour here. There's so many questions and you have inspired a lot of great conversation. So I hope this is just the beginning of working together. And yeah, thank you so much for presenting, sharing all of your great thoughts and insights. We really appreciate your time and super glad to have you in the Vermont community.
Thank you. I'm so honored to be here and to share time with you all today. Thank you.